My Hill Nero theorem is nothing but I go to the diagram, it looks big, it sounds big. My Hill Nero theorem only says that number of equivalent classes for regular language should be limited. Example, say the language a to the power n, b to the power n. What is the number of equivalence classes in the language? You purely understand a to the power n, b to the power n means it is the language ab plus a square b square plus a cube b cube plus a4b4 means 4 a's and 4 b's plus a to the power n, b to the power n, n goes to 1 to infinity. So, what are the number of equivalent classes? Infinity. So, this cannot be your regular language. That is this. But if you can ask, a to the power, and another way you can check it, that FSM, you cannot design FSM without stack to recognize the a to the power n, b to the power n language properly. So, you need to have stack to, when the a's are coming, you put them into the stack, and when b's are coming, you pop each a and matching b, take it out. So, this is several ways you can find the language is not regular or regular. So, My Hill theorem, Nero theorem just says that number of equivalence classes should be limited. That's all. These recursively enumerable grammar and non-recursively enumerable grammar, there are two stages. These are all in the type 0 language. Am I getting to you? Type 3 is the shortest region is the finite language by combinatorial science. Then the regular language, okay, that is type 3. Then the type 2. Type 2 is context-free language. Type 2 has many varieties. One is deterministic context-free, which is our basis of programming languages, which should have some unambiguous grammar. And whatever you are telling, then comes the context-sensitive grammar. That is a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n. Okay, that can be solved by the Turing machine, bounded Turing machine. We call it linear bounded automata. Turing machine, the definition of Turing machine is it can go left to infinity and right also infinity, but if we can bound it, a Turing machine, that is called linear bounded automata. Nobody is much great into study into linear bounded automata, because you can ask the like finite state machine, it can be deterministic, non-deterministic, but it is found and proven that it is a power is same. If you can take a non-deterministic finite state machine with epsilon or without epsilon, we can convert it to FSM, and we have covered in one lecture, but one more lecture is due, that is with epsilon. I'll make a presentation with epsilon, a non-deterministic finite state machine converted to finite state machine, deterministic finite state machine. So, power is same, but whenever it comes to deterministic pushdown automata and non-deterministic pushdown automata, deterministic pushdown automata is basically which detects the parenthesis grammar, like opening braces, closing braces, or a to the power n, b to the power n language, two main types of language. These deterministic context-free grammar can be detected by deterministic pushdown automata with FSM, and most of 99% programming languages belongs to this formal language. So, programming language are nothing but extension of this formal language, which should have a unambiguous grammar. At least you have now understood the language and grammar two different things. Language should have a grammar. A language can have a 10 number of grammars or more than 10 number of grammars. But if any one grammar gives unambiguous parsing tree, then we call that language with that particular grammar is unambiguous and definitely a fit case for programming language. So, that comes to this language and grammar part. But for regular language, everything is 1:1. Okay, if the FSM is minimized FSM, then that should be unique. But that cannot be said in the deterministic context-free grammar. Say, a deterministic context-free language, a language can have many grammar and maybe more than one grammar unambiguous. Which one will take, that is his or her convenience. So that is one thing I want to mention. Then comes the non-deterministic pushdown automata. Example is palindrome grammar. Palindrome can be two types, odd palindrome and even palindrome. But if you see a palindrome, yesterday class I mentioned, I think Pritam's question, if a palindrome is divided by a hash or something unique thing, then this detection of palindrome can be easily done by a deterministic pushdown automata. Because whenever it goes from left to right, it pulls them. Whenever hash denotes it that it is now midpoint comes, then when the palindrome again starts from, then it pops. So that is a fairly simple case. So for deterministic pushdown automata, but palindrome without this internal marker or odd palindrome, it can be detected only by non-deterministic pushdown automata by random choice, by any of the choice. If one of the it got it, then we say it's fine. But it is very very difficult to get it. Next stage is a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n language. We call it context sensitive grammar. If you see the rules of context sensitive grammar, that means your left hand side variable can have another terminal and all these things. This is can be detected by linear bounded automata. I have told you that is a Turing machine with the boundaries, and this Turing machine with boundary with determinism or non-determinism, it is still a research topic, but everybody says it will be not interested, because I am coming to why. Because next language is type 0 language. That type 0 language, there are many layers. That is the reason Turing halting problem is one example. But one good thing about this portion, if you can write any formula like a to the power n, b to the power n is okay. But any size like b square minus 4ac root over like 2a, like root of a quadratic equation, it can be done by the Turing machine. That I can guarantee. So that is the thing, any formula can be done. So, but there are some problems which cannot be done by Turing machine. Like you cannot design a program whose input is another program, and your program will decide will that program give stop or non-stop. Then Turing is always, Turing machine loops around. Like it will, you can call it a infinite loop, or it might stop. That's called halt. Halt is good. I am telling you, halt is good. Halt means at least it halt. But this is called Turing halting problem. Turing may halt, may not halt. So that problem is undecidable. That is the reason. So not all problems are decided. Okay. Because whenever it comes to this automata class, I first few classes, I told you the difference between the difference of algorithms, types of algorithms, complexities of algorithms. Like some algorithms are linear algorithms, like linear search and all this. Then binary search, you know, in data structure, it is a, in a binary search tree, it is a log n. Then if you go MART sort, is n log n. And insertion sort is n squared. But again, the issues are there. When the number of items is 32, then maybe insertion sort is quicker than MART sort. So MART sort is meant for huge data. Then when it is divide and conquer, when it comes to around 16 and 13, then it generally converted to insertion sort. So these are combinations of sorting algorithms are there. Then the complexities comes a different angle altogether. Like whenever you see us, it comes different because this is a 2 to the power n problem. This is, by any way, you cannot solve this Tower of Hanoi problem, 2 to the power n. So this is the problem because you have to shift one pole to another. Then I'll give you an example of traveling salesman problem. That is a very complex problem, factorial n problem. Factorial n problems are, many problems are factorial n, like not scheduling problem in a COVID situation. Say if you have 100, say if Amri, Dakuria, you have 200 NARS, there are some several duties, no duties cannot be two duties together, there must be given some relaxation and all this. This NARS scheduling problem, it is a tough problem. It is not in n square, it is not n number of knots, it is not that 2 to the power 100, it is a big number, it's a, some factorial issues are there. Then will come some problems are there that is uncomputable, some problems are uncomputable. So, this but before, uncomputable and computable border region active computer science research is there and this thing. So, these languages are basically for theoretical. It cannot be done because these are complexities. It cannot only the deterministic context free grammar can be compiled in the linear time. These times are very exponential time. That Albert Einstein, Alan Turing, they are genius. Okay, if they not come, the whole see if Albert Einstein do not write in 1905 thesis. I think you know from he wrote four papers in 1905 to 1906. They change whole the Newtonian mechanics. Okay, whole basic things are changed. More you can get more accurate result. Same for in computer science. I think it starts from Alan Turing, that seminal paper in 1936-1937, he showed a very simple way that a strip of papers in square boxes, you put some write the like zero ones, some strings, and you can make a finite state machine with read head and write head. It go one step forward or one step backward, but it must do it. It can write it also. So, this simple machine can solve any algorithm. So, that is a great idea. That is a great idea. But this is very difficult to design in machine. We choose the different machine. Finite state machine discovery came late half of 40s and 50s. Pushed down Ottawa's 51 paper. 51, 52, even your theory, all this automata, finite state machine and all these pushdown automata is covered in 50s only, 50, 51 to 59. And again, the another seminal paper, another big paper that one man changed the whole formal language, the language part, that is Noam Chomsky. So, that is, he first invented the language that type 3. Type 3, type 2, type 1, type 0. Alan Turing, so Alan Turing is a genius, same for Noam Chomsky. So, these are the big two pillars of the computer science and others are all are big. So you coming back to your question, Turing machine is a theoretical machine. Our laptop is also a Turing machine, approximation Turing machine. What is this? Your memory, your laptop may be 16 GB RAM or 8 GB RAM, that we consider a strip of that 01 block, and your CPU is the finite state machine with your all registers and all this thing. So, your CPU is just reading from left to right, your program is written in compiled code, in executable code, and it puts it output in the memory itself, and you can see this memory in the display code. So, all machines, whatever we are using right now, they are approximation of Turing machine. But quantum computing, if you are interested, if you can read, that is a little bit away. So, that is we are thinking that quantum machines, the algorithms complexity will change. Yeah, some very good algorithms are there, but some algorithm we have the complexity would be the same. If the quantum computing comes by Google, IBM and all, this whole scenario should be changed. Quantum computing would definitely is pushing ahead. So, that is the baby stretch Turing machine. Right now, till now, Turing machine is the most powerful computer, but the simple. People generally comes ahead and propose first, and then the other things are there. Because even in Turing machine, you need a finite state machine. So, all the finite state machine, if you see the Kohobi's book, say the finite state machine is a very complex thing. It is not that simple, that not only millimode, because a finite state machine some has can have a zero and sometimes you give a one, it go to ignore. So, there may be many state, we have to how to combine the many state, Some state may not have label ignore state. So there may be several ignore state. So there, how to compact those states, that is minimization of states, and then you need that. And sometimes I think has raised that how to minimize this finite state machine, that I have told you, there must be in any finite state machine, there must be an one start, only one start, and maybe one or more accepting states. So first you have to divide the states into divide and conquer policy, all accepting state and all non-accepting. On the right hand side all accepting, left hand side all non-accepting. Then you start with the, say your input alphabet 0 and 1, and if see the left hand side like not accepting state, and it jumps to whether accepting state group or non-accepting state group. If they some of the state group with minimum alphabet 0 or 1, it goes to one, some state go to accepting and some non-accepting, then again you divide. So that way, that is called one excitation, how many different types of state you are getting. That way you initially you have two groups of state machine, then with one extra initiation, whether you have a same group, if you are, that is called irrecognizable, that is called whether then you say, if then it is recognizable, you divide the group, maybe you have a 16 state, you come to that way 8 groups, but now in 8 groups, they are staying the same group, so each group may contain 2 numbers, may not be 2, so you can combine those states. So that is one minimization algorithm I will cover, but that is a finite state machine, has a huge potential. In fact, all VLSI circuit, you have to be expert in finite state machine. There are also memory loss, and that Turing has invented that part. But regarding finite state machine, is actually core of the things. It has to be realizable on a VLSI circuit, and so there are a lot of research is still going on. This is I not expect from you. Thank you.